Welcome to the Commentaries, a podcast series from TAN in which you'll learn how to read and understand history's greatest Catholic works from today's greatest Catholic scholars. In every series of the Commentaries, your expert host will be your personal guide to not just read the book, but to live the book, shining the light of its eternal truths into our modern darkness. Visit tancommentaries.com to get your copy of the book and to subscribe for access to all the great reading plans, new episodes, bonus content, and exclusive deals for listeners of the Commentaries.
Hello, and welcome back. I'm Father Edward Looney. I'm a priest of the Diocese of Green Bay, a pastor, an author, a podcaster, and Marian theologian, and at present, the president of the Mariological Society of America. And this is the Commentaries series on the Glories of Mary by St. Alphonsus Liguori. Today is day number 11, and we will be concluding our study of part one of the Glories of Mary by looking at the devout prayers addressed by various saints to the Divine Mother. But before we dive into these prayers, why don't we say a prayer ourselves? And why don't we have recourse in our prayer in the ancient and oldest prayer to Our Lady called the Sub Tuum Presidium? We fly to thy protection, O Holy Mother of God. Despise not our petitions and our necessities, but deliver us always from all dangers, O glorious and blessed Virgin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. When it comes to these prayers that we encounter in the concluding section of part one, and I should say that there are other prayers too that are contained towards the end of the second part as well. Actually, in the third part, there are different little prayers and such that you could have recourse to. But we will focus on these prayers in the first part. There's really a way that we could look at these prayers, I guess, generally speaking. I like to maybe call this the anatomy of a prayer. I think it's so important for us that we learn how to pray, that we come to a knowledge of how to structure prayer and such. And that happens by reading the words of other prayers. It's the value of scripted prayer. Some people might not like a prayer book. When I was learning to pray as a young boy, I had prayer books. There was one from Queenship Publishing called Pray, Pray, Pray. A lot of people know of the Pieta prayer book. There are any number of prayer books. I remember there was one, had a little picture of Jesus on the front, and I think it came from some sisters out in New York or something. Had various prayers. One, like, I remember vividly, a prayer to St. Lucy and such. So, prayer books are valuable, I think. We could just go to the pages of sacred scripture and find prayers, too. Go to the book of Esther, Queen Esther. Read her prayer. Powerful stuff. We have the saints who have written prayers. That's who have written the prayers in this section of the Glories of Mary. But I think about, you know, a saint like Saint Faustina, for example. She has some prayers. She was taught prayers by the Lord Jesus, but then she wrote prayers to the Lord. Think about any number of saints. Saint Alphonsus Liguori. He gave us a set of stations meditations. And there are some beautiful phrases in them, like, I repent of my sins and I will strive not to offend you anymore, or something along those lines. Just, I love you, my Jesus, with all my heart, and I repent of ever having done you wrong. And he has you repeat that phrase over and over again. Not to babble like the pagans, but so that as we say those words, we might begin to mean them. We could look at any number one of these prayers and analyze it and look at it. But I think the value of these prayers is that they're teaching us the language of prayer. What are some of the themes? There's the notion of protection. We actually just had that in the Subtuum Presidium. We fly to thy protection, O Holy Mother of God. So we're telling the Mother of God, I'm flying to you for protection. It's almost like we're going in her mantle. She's wrapping that around us. Bernard, Saint Bernard in this prayer, in this section, asks Mary for assistance in judgment, or at his judgment. Sometimes these prayers, you know, they tell Mary something about who she is. She knows these things, right? But you were chosen among all women. We kind of use this language, kind of building up why it is that we're calling upon her. Draw me that I might run after thee. Just beautiful little language at times. You have received grace to assist us. And maybe one of the most common things in all of these prayers is just how they use titles of Our Lady. That they use titles like Mother, or Virgin, or Queen. Blessed, glorious, you know, descriptive words of who Mary is. Why don't we just look at one prayer? And I'm choosing a shorter prayer. There's no reason why. I could have chosen a longer one, but just think in the interest of our time, it's easier to look at a shorter one. Let's look at the prayer of Saint Anselm. And I'm choosing Saint Anselm because when I was in seminary, I was deeply touched by his writings, his proof for the existence of God. And I looked, and in the library, they had a book, Prayers and Devotions of Saint Anselm. And I checked it out, and I began praying the prayers of Saint Anselm. So let's hear how he prays to Our Lady. We beseech thee, O most holy Lady, by the favor that God did thee, in raising thee so high as to make all things possible to thee with him, so to act with the plenitude of grace which thou didst merit, may render us partakers of thy glory. Strive, O most merciful Lady, to obtain for us that for which God was pleased to become man in thy chaste womb. O lend us a willing ear. If thou deignest to pray to thy Son for this, he will immediately grant it. It suffices that thou willest our salvation, and then we are sure to obtain it. But who can restrain thy great mercy, if thou who art our mother and the mother of mercy dost not pity us? What will become of us when thy Son comes to judge us? Help us then, O most compassionate Lady, and consider not the multitude of our sins. Remember always that our Creator took human flesh of thee, not to condemn sinners, but to save them. If thou hadst become Mother of God only for thine own advantage, we might say that it signified little to thee whether we were lost or saved, but God clothed himself with thy flesh for thy salvation and for that of all men. What would thy great power and glory avail us, if thou dost not make us partakers of thy happiness? O, help us then and protect us. Thou knowest how greatly we stand in need of thy assistance. We recommend ourselves to thee. O let us not lose our souls, but make us eternally serve and love thy beloved Son, Jesus Christ. There's a lot going on in that prayer, and maybe as you heard that prayer, you're like, well, why is it necessary to say all of these things? And, you know, maybe the prayer is a little bit cumbersome. Maybe there's a bit much there. Maybe it could be simplified. I'm not going to disagree with you, but this is a prayer of a saint. But notice what he does. We beseech thee, O most holy lady. He addresses her, strive, O most merciful lady, to obtain for us that for which God was pleased. But what does Mary do? She obtains something for us. In this prayer, he calls her lady, but also, if thou who art our mother and the mother of mercy does not pity us. So speaking of Mary's role as mother, mother of God, only for thine own advantage. So kind of talking to Mary about her own situation. You were not mother just because it was good for you, but it's good for all of us that you were mother. Oh, help us then and protect us. Thou knowest how greatly we stand in need of thy assistance. Well, Mary, as we address her, she knows our need of her assistance. But it probably delights her as mother to know that we are relying upon her, that we stand in need of her intercession for each and every one of us. So, these saints whose prayers are here, they're teaching us the language of prayer. They're a model so that then we can craft our own prayer. Just think, how is it that you would address a prayer to Our Lady? So quite simply, let's craft a prayer together right now, or allow me to lead you and how I would craft a prayer to Mary. So let's say I'm going to call upon Our Lady, and maybe I'm going to ask for a specific grace. I'm going to ask her for the grace of doing God's will. Okay, so I know what I'm going to ask for, so how am I going to address Our Lady then, asking for that grace? Maybe I would call to mind the Annunciation in which Mary was chosen by God and she ascends to the will of God. I'm going to pray that Mary will obtain for me the grace of doing God's will. So if I was going to craft a prayer, this is maybe how it would go. O handmaid of Nazareth, you were chosen by God at the very moment of your conception to be his mother, to give birth to the second person of the Trinity, to conceive the Lord Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. God the Father found you worthy. He preserved you from original sin. He called you and prepared you all the days of your life leading up to this moment. And at the right time, he sent an angel to announce this good news, to share with you that God was going to become man by you. You asked, how can this be, since I have no relations with a man? Not because you doubted what God was going to do, but because you knew that it had to be by the very power of God that this took place, because of your state in life and because of your promise. God willed for you to be his mother. And to that will you said, let it be done to me according to your will. Your son Jesus taught us to pray, thy will be done. And I ask you, Mary, as my mother, to obtain for me the grace of doing God's will, that I might listen for his voice, that I might put into action what he asks me to do, that I might carry out and fulfill his plan for me. Mary, I want to do God's will. I want what he wants for me. Help me to imitate you in that generous response, in doing and knowing and following God's will. You who are full of grace, obtain this for me. Amen. So that was a prayer that, I'll be honest, I didn't write. That was completely from the heart. I was writing it as I was saying it, not literally writing it, but giving voice to it. God was originating it within me. But if you think about that prayer, well, how did I first call upon her? Handmaid of Nazareth. Kind of one of those titles, but it fits. Because it's because she is the handmaid that I am calling upon her help in doing God's will. And then I prayed and spoke to Our Lady about God choosing her and how this was a part of God's plan and how she allowed herself to be used in this moment. I used words from the gospel, from this account, quoting them in this prayer. Maybe as a little exercise for yourself. You know, here we have just reflected in part one on the Salve Regina, a prayer to Our Lady, Hail Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, our life, our sweetness, and our hope. We could model our prayer somewhat off of that prayer. O Mary, show us your son Jesus. Show me how he is present in my life. Show me your son Jesus at the hour of my death so that I might be united with him forever and might praise him alongside you in heaven. Again, that's just a very simple prayer, taking a little theme, putting words together, articulating it to our Lord and to Our Lady. I would encourage you as a spiritual practice now, read these prayers that conclude the first part of the Glories of Mary. And then take out a piece of paper and write a prayer to Our Lady, inspired by these prayers that you just read and prayed through. How is it that they are teaching you the language of prayer, especially the language of prayer of addressing our Blessed Mother? This brings us to the close of today's reflection for day 11, in which we've looked at the anatomy of a Marian prayer. I hope you'll join me tomorrow as we begin to examine the discourses of St. Alphonsus Liguori. And we will do so first by examining the Immaculate Conception, Discourse 1 of Part 2. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you. And may she pray for you in the ways that you now ask her and want her to.
This has been an episode of The Commentaries, a podcast brought to you by Tan. To follow the show, study more of the greatest Catholic classics, and to support The Commentaries and other great free content from Tan, visit tancommentaries.com to subscribe and use coupon code COM25 to get 25% off your next order, including the Glories of Mary and countless more spiritual works to deepen your interior life and guide you to heaven.